Hi everyone. Continuing from yesterday, do you want me to start with rights first?
Hi. Before you start, can you please get back to explaining what is the basic difference between sensitive personal data information and personal data information? I understand one is a subset of another, but how does one differ from the other, and what is the remaining part?
Okay. So, have you understood what personal data identifiers mean? Have you understood this definition separately before I start with the difference? Or do you want me to repeat the entire thing?
What I understand is any information that is personal to somebody and might lead to certain discrimination or judgment or...
So, any information... Okay, directly or indirectly, when it is capable of identifying an individual, qualifies as personal information or personal data. Now, any personal data becomes or transits into the category of sensitive personal data when the misuse or misappropriation of such data sets can actually lead to harm being caused to the individual, can cause the individual embarrassment, or can cause the individual cause discrimination against the individual. That is when any personal data identifier qualifies to be sensitive personal data. So it is data elements like genetic information, medical information, your sexual orientation, financial information, political affiliations, trade union memberships. They all qualify as sensitive personal data because they have the elements of a certain degree of harm to be caused to you. Is that clear?
Yes, but even the information like my name would also cause me certain discrimination or judgment or affect by the society to me in certain situations. Will that not be sensitive?
I think you're talking about communal undertones and all. I get what
yes.
You're for caste affiliations. So caste right. Criteria which was being judged to be added to the sensitive personal identifiers here in India. But, to be really honest, you need that basic identifier to be able to even create a profile for an individual. So if qualifying per names as sensitive personal data will not be prudent to say from, a practical point of view.
All right.
So that's that. So for that matter, age and date of birth can also be used to discriminate against you. But those
correct.
Are essential elements.
Okay.
Is that okay, Naya?
Sorry?
Is that okay?
Yes. Thank
Does
you.
Does anybody have any other questions from yesterday before I start with rights?
Agni, I had sent you one question regarding the, the holding subsidiary relationship and how that sharing of data impacts that.
So that is to do with cross-border transfers. So would you want me to start with cross-border transfers?
No, I'm just saying address that during the course today.
No, so I will do that during the course of my explanation of cross-border transfers.
Mm-hmm.
Because that is a situation, right?
Yeah.
Take it. Then I will start with rights.
Yeah, do that.
Okay. Tell the screen. Okay, so the most basic form of rights or the type of rights are the right to access, the right to rectification, the right to objection, and the right to erasure and data portability. So I will start with the right of access. Now, right of access, I'm using GDPR as a basis to explain these principles because they speak, they explain them at in a better manner. And what has happened with the bill is most of copy-pasting. So I would actually fall back on the GDPR to try to explain the principles basically to you guys. Now, can everybody see this? Can you guys see my screen?
Yes.
So under a right to access, this is also a right which is currently subsisting with us. I mean, all of us already have this under the IT rules of 2011. In addition, the Personal Data Protection Bill, since it will be the umbrella legislation, it's trying to codify it in that particular form where it will be referred to as a right to access. All these rights have been clubbed under Rule 5 of the Sensitive Personal Data Data or Information Rules of 2011 in its current form, but they are separately called out under the PDP Bill. Now, GDPR also has this right of access, and several other legislations across the globe, including Mexico, Vietnam, Philippines, and Canada, Australia, they have similar sets of rights. So right to access is in the most basic form, allows or empowers a data subject to reach out to the data controller and ask every category of information, every data identifier pertaining to that particular data subject that is available with the data controller, the purpose of such processing, the any disclosures which have happened so far, or the retention period, and any form of processing that has taken place, basically, which could be a transfer, which could be a profiling, which could be disclosures, which could be in the form of using that information to provide service to the data subject. All of this can be sought by the data subject under this right to access. I have actually so this is an example of how a person, an individual, tries to reach out to a data controller and enforces their own right to access. Now, Uber allows you to actually go onto their website, log into your profile, I mean, use your email ID, your phone number, and your password details. And then you find a page, you reach this page under the privacy policy section. There is a, okay, there is a drop-up where you can actually go ahead and place your request to right to access. Now, when you select that and you Uber redirects you to another page, that is this page, where it tells you that this is all that will be included in the list or the dump that they share with you. And then if you look at this, they also ask you, what is the reason behind you wanting to access the data that is available with them about you? Now, while you might want to contest why they are wanting to know why, I want to know or access my data, it is for one simple reason, that the recitals to GDPR also understand that while a data controller is under the obligation to provide or furnish the data and the use cases and everything that is related to you, the profile that they have built on you, to be made available to you, there is a certain cost which might go into it, or there is a certain effort that might go into it. So in that scenario, while the data is supposed to be made available to you by the data controller for free, if you ask for multiple copies of the data sets to be given to you, or if you ask for the data to be presented to you in a certain format, which is probably not the format that the data controller follows on a day-to-day basis, then the data controller has the right or has the option, the discretion, to come back to you and say that that could be a certain nominal cost or administrative cost which will go into making that data available to you. So this is an example of how you actually can process a request with an entity like Uber. If you look here, did somebody say something? So if you look at this here, there are four categories of data that they have. Mute everyone else.
I'll just do that.
So if you look at this particular section, since Uber also had the entity Uber Eats under it, so in that sense, when you reach out to Uber, and since those entities were one and the same, and it was not an entirely separate entity which was managing Uber Eats in India, at least, when you approach or when you put this request, this is the page you land at, and it tells you that you will receive your account data, you will receive your Uber rider data, you will receive your Uber Eats data, and the jump data. Jump data is basically the database, I mean the analytics, but something that can be understood by you or cannot be replicated by you, and it is necessary for you. So it is in that sense they have accepted my request. Now I'll take to the next page. So in addition to the analytics, your jump data also refers to the jump bikes that were added to the Uber ride services. And if you see, they have tried to explain what is the nature of data or what are the identifiers, particularly under account data, rider data, jump data, and Uber Eats data that they will make available to you. So if you see, they are also within account data. The first line entry is mostly personal data identifiers, while the third, second, and fourth one, they carry certain elements of sensitive personal data. So that is how this, I do not have the data set actually, I have misplaced it. So I could have shown you what happens when they actually share that with you. But I think, Shreyan, are you on call?
Yeah.
Will you be able to explain when they, would you want to walk people through how the data set actually looks like once you receive it?
So I don't know how this one comes. When I had applied, I had just asked for whatever information they had. They had given the information in an Excel sheet. So it was in the similar tabular format that you were showing yesterday, but the parameters were mostly about coordinates, time, drop-off location, pick-up location, the cost, the distance traveled, and I think the name of the driver also. So that way you could somehow calculate how much you were spending per month and you get an idea. That was the whole idea behind it.
Okay. Thanks, Shreyan. So like Shreyan mentioned, and like I yesterday also mentioned, that when we, you were referring to the PDI, right?
Yes.
Okay. So one of the use cases or one of the better ways to manage data subject requests is to actually host or to maintain personal data inventory at the end of the data controller. Because like Shreyan mentioned right now, whenever there is a request that is received from a data subject, it becomes very easy to trace the data identifiers. It becomes very easy to actually keep track of everything that is pertaining to one individual, and to be able to extract that data into a conversational or into a readable form to be sent back to the individual concerned. So that is one of the good, one of the better use cases of PDI, apart from privacy compliance, of course. So this is right to access. Going back to right to rectification. Right to rectification also is available under the IT rules, and a data subject can approach a data controller at any point of time, requesting them to rectify, to update, and to substitute any incorrect data entry made at the end of the data controller, and to update it as per without any undue delay, to avoid that no inaccurate data is being processed. Because there is a possibility that if they are not maintaining their records in a certain manner, or if they are not updating, or if there is any wrong data entry, it could result in causing some harm to the data subject. So it is going back to the principle of maintaining data accuracy. Right to rectification is married to that particular principle and is also essential. So this is how there is no specific format for a rectification request that has been provided under GDPR or is prevalent. It is a simple line, email or application, or if there is a helpline within your account settings on a particular product or solution, you can just go right to the grievance redressal officer or right to the data privacy officer, and they will execute this for you. Now, before we come to right to erasure and portability, I will first cover the other rights. This is the right to restriction of processing. I would really request you all to go through the first clause of this article. So right to restriction of processing actually can be, if you look at points A, I mean the sub clauses A, B, C and D, they are pretty much wide in the sense that a data subject can ask the data controller to refrain from processing, from continuous processing of the data sets that they have with them, without actually forcing the data controller to remove or basically to purge or to remove or to, you know, delete the data. So what is important here is it only restricts the data controller to continuously use, to put the data sets to continuous use when they take the time to probably, in the case of the first point, to update and ensure accuracy of the personal data, or where the data subject is opposing the erasure of the personal data. This could also be because of retention policies. So in that scenario, the data subject has the right to ask, reach out to the data controller and tell them that while I do not want you to delete the information from your system, I just want you to discontinue from processing that particular data sets that is available with the data controller. Again, where if you look at subclass C, it states that the data controller no longer needs the personal data for the purposes of processing, but they are required by the data subject for the establishment, exercise or defense of legal claims. Again, where a data subject has necessary information available with the service provider, but the service provider, I mean the data controller, is under no legal obligation to continue with the storage of that data, the data subject has the right to reach out to the controller and ask them to retain the data for that particular timeline that he or she might need it for. So data, Article 21 is again right to object. We will discuss that when we go there. So basically in terms of right to restriction of processing, the data subject has to establish a valid cause for why it wants the, he or she wants the data controller to continue retaining the data while not putting it to a use case, because it's again involves cost. So it is not an absolute right, but it is something that the data protection officer at the end of the data controller will evaluate and see if it is possible to be able to do that or not. Now moving on to right to object. Could you please go through the first two clauses? So in the context of right to object, it is mostly focusing on two elements, that is the profiling that is done of a data subject or for direct marketing purposes. Now for profiling, what is important is there are three essential elements which are looked into in case of deciding if a certain entity is profiling a data subject or not. Where an automated decision, an automated processing is happening without human intervention of personal data to predict behavior of those people. These three elements, that is the automated processing, personal data, and for the purposes of predicting behavior of people, these three elements together and you know result in what is known as profiling of an individual. Profiling is not allowed in most of the jurisdictions across the globe. Also in India, it is not allowed. I mean, under the Personal Data Protection Bill, it will not be suited for an entity to be profiling an individual, because predicting behavioral patterns can cause a greater damage, and because of the Cambridge Analytica issue and because of other breaches and other incidents that are happening across the globe, profiling is not just, it's not just frowned upon, it is something that is not allowed. So in that scenario, it has been, I mean, entities have been subjected to a right to object. I mean, the data subjects have been empowered with the right to object, where they can restrict the data controller from going ahead and creating a profile about that individual for the specific purposes of utilizing those profiles without the purposes that were initially agreed to with the data subject. Am I making sense, or should I give you an example to be able to?
Please give an example.
Okay. So in case where, let's say, I will talk about Facebook only, where I created my first, when I first created my profile, my social media profile, while they, you know, Facebook uses all of that to also target ads at me, or for that matter to actually show me, if I start viewing one set of videos, the videos which are recommended to me separately also are similar in nature or probably in line with what I have selected myself. Now, since it is an essential element of the services that Facebook is providing to me as a user, that level of profiling is okay. But where Facebook uses my profile to, like what happened in the matter of Cambridge Analytica, where Facebook is using my profile to put it to purposes or use cases which was not predefined or which was not communicated to me and for which I did not consent, I have the right to object to such profiling or for such you know, processing of information in that particular manner. Is that example clear?
Yes.
Okay. So now moving on to direct marketing purposes, prior to GDPR, because this is a regulation, it has you know, default application across the entire European Union, European Economic Area. Prior to this, there was the European Union directive, and directives have to be internalized and they have to be, you know, replicated through national legislations across the European Union and those other states in the European Economic Area. All the countries had policies or regulations or legislations which were concerning with direct marketing, and most of them were also, you know, overlapping with telecommunication laws. Now, when GDPR came to place, this became an essential element and it was baked into the GDPR, and certain states continue to have direct marketing laws or direct communication laws, like we also have under our TRAI regulations. So again, a data subject has the right to object to any processing of personal data for direct marketing purposes. So again, similarly, while Facebook can create a profile for me which is tailoring or suited to my particular usage of Facebook, Facebook is not supposed to use my Facebook account to actually sell products to me or to direct you know, advertisement ads, sorry, direct marketing ads, or try to use my Facebook account to communicate for the purposes of direct marketing. And then also go ahead and sell it to, I mean, sell that information to other service providers, other product chains, other retailers for communicating with me. So right to object is more of a right which came with the focus of to, you know, curtail these two scenarios which were prevalent in the context that this right came to be. Again, it is another thing that I will mention here is I will not discuss Article 22, but I will tell you in this context only what it speaks of when it is talking about automated individual decision making. In the context of the European scenario, what was happening was multiple companies or entities which have, you know, mandatory, what do you say, working hours, or whether they were the employees were required to punch a certain number of hours on the floor or on their systems. What was happening is too many entities were receiving these, or, you know, the HR functions or the team leads, they were receiving flags where they would see that a certain employee has probably not logged in for 9 hours continuously, or, you know, because I will tell you, in my previous role also, our systems had features which could actually tell that if I have a Word document open, but I'm actually not typing, but the Word document is open. So that would mean Bagmi Shikha Puhan is sitting on a system and is continuing to work. It was not, you know, imperative, or it was not necessary for me to actually be working or typing, or, you know, for that matter, even looking at the document. So these were controls that were implemented by companies to an extent where all of this information was being fed into a common repository and where there was no human intervention, and automatically these triggers, these lists were being generated where employers could go ahead and actually use this to say that an employee has been deficient in their services and could then actually end up removing that employee from their payrolls. Now, in that scenario, what happened was people decided, since this became prevalent, what happened was a person in such a scenario where an excuse was given, like they have not maintained their logs, or where they have time entries do not match with the actual time spent on the system, or access cards reflected something else, but the person fed in something else in their time sheets. So to curtail that and to avoid that, this automated decision making also came in the context where any task or any conclusion or any action which is taken by an employer or similarly by any other data controller cannot happen if that action has been caused by pure automated decision making. So right now I'll give you another example. I'll use the example of health, where a doctor can use automated means to research and evaluate or to assess the condition of a patient. The AI system or the automated tools cannot actually be the ones responsible to generate a prescription. So to avoid all these unforeseen circumstances or all these adverse situations, the data subject is also empowered with the right to object to automated individual decision making, and under GDPR, at any given instance where any decision has been taken against a data subject, there has to be human intervention, and it cannot be basis pure automated means. So that is more or less about this. If you're clear, then I can move to right to data portability. Are we clear on the other rights?
Yes.
Okay.
Sorry, on point number one, I had a question.
On right to access?
No, the previous point you were talking about, right to profiling, right to object to profiling. So there it talks about compelling legitimate reasons, as an exception. If you look at the second part of point number one, compelling legitimate grounds for processing, which override the interests, rights, and freedoms of data subject. So this, I'm assuming, would be, reasons pertaining to LEA, right?
Yes.
Have there been any criteria laid down in judicial interpretations of this, or maybe some other clarification issued as to what all this could include?
If you look at the Article 29 Working Party Guidance on Right to Object, if you look at the debates that took place between the data protection authorities, they're mostly contractual ground could be a ground, but it is not suitable for a data controller to entirely rely on a contractual ground. They cannot say that since we have a contract with probably another data controller who has similar obligations and is under an obligation to retain or store such data or to be able to process such data, that is not sufficient. While they provide for it, it is more on a case-to-case basis. So like you said, it is focusing on LEA issues only. It's only for establishment of, or for defending legal claims or, like you said, law enforcement agencies only. But one of the criteria is contractual obligations, or for that matter, any other statutory obligations that are also there. That is again covered under LEA. So these are the two grounds which are considered, and again, health issues are also considered, and then public emergency, all the other, public interest and those general principles. But I will actually share that particular discussion from the guidance document from the working party. It's an interesting read. All the rights have been very well, explained or understood, and they have been considered, all the aspects have been considered very well. So you can actually, all of you can look at Article 29 Working Party guidances. For that matter, the Singaporean Personal Data Protection Authority also has good guidances on all these rights. I'll share the links and I'll share the documents also.
Sure, thanks.
Okay, another thing that I had actually forgotten to mention is that all these rights, right to access and your right to object and restriction of processing, is basis the data sets that you or I as data subjects have fed into the system. For any data analytics or any aggregated data sets, any anonymized data sets which are generated at the end of the data controller or processor for that matter, these rights do not cover them. So when I am accessing, if you look at Uber rights, Uber also, when I was accessing my data, it's mostly information which I have fed or which directly related to me. But it will not give me the data if it has turned into an aggregated data sets, or let's say if they are on the back end trying to figure out if Bagmishikha Puhan makes, her destinations are more in the nature of restaurants, or if they are, if I have more visits to hospitals, or if I have more visits to religious places. Even if they're doing that in the back end, let's say even with my own consent, they are not required to provide such information to me. That I'm just saying that it's a use case. I'm not saying it's, I mean, we are not talking about how right it is or how wrong it is, but the data controller is under no obligation to give me information that they have computed or they have generated at their end, basis my data. So that is one element which applies to all the rights, including data portability and the right to erasure. Then we'll...
I have a question. So in case your primary information that we have fed into their systems, whatever systems, is incorrect on certain premises, is not accurate, then whatever information that is aggregated by the processor or the controller will also have a defect or will be deficient to accuracy. So are you saying that we will not have any control over that aggregated information, even if that's incorrect?
Yes, we will not have any control over that. But the thing is, again, we have to go back to the first instance of what you're saying is, it is under the Personal Data Protection Bill also, it is incumbent on the data controller to ensure that the data is accurate. The idea is that the information is not incorrect. Well, the processing is happening only basis information which is accurate and updated. So that is why we came with principles first, and then you come to the concept of the rights. If you see, the entire objective is to, even if you look at right to rectification, also derives from the right to, I mean, from the principle of accuracy. So it is assumed or presumed that all the data sets that are available with the controller is true and is accurate, because that is also one of the undertakings that you as a data subject are signing off to when you sign off to the terms of use or to the privacy policy. When you're consenting, it is one of the elements that go into it, that whatever you're presenting to them is kind of a warranty. You're warranting that it is true to your best knowledge, or it is true on such date. And remember, aggregated data sets will not have the reason why even the legislatures look at aggregated data sets. There is certain leeway or certain freedom given to such data sets, is because the harm that aggregated data sets can cause cannot be related directly to what harm can be caused to you where your direct identifiers are used against you. Am I making any sense?
Yes.
Are you following?
Yes.
Take it. So moving on to right to data portability.
Sorry, I just have one more question on that.
Ji.
So if a data controller runs a bunch of processing activities on the data submitted by the data subject, and that results into some additional data about the subject, which is still personally identifiable, then can the data subject under the right to access ask for information to that output as well?
Can you give me an example?
I can't really think of anything right now, but could be any processing activity, any analytics that they run on the data, and the output that comes about still is not anonymized.
No, anonymized, it doesn't have to be anonymized. Anonymized is a standard. Anonymized data sets do not even come under the purview of...
Correct. The act, I mean, the law will not apply to that, right? The act will not apply to that.
Yes, this will not come. But if you're talking about direct identifiers, I cannot think of use cases, but if I can... think of, I can probably tell you, but in that scenario, The chances of it are too low, actually, because analytics doesn't happen. I mean, it happens on identifiers which are resulting in a particular activity. Like even the example of Uber I gave, for Uber to try and map my account, I mean, to create a backend profile where they're saying that one particular user of this age group or of this ethnicity or whatever, let's say they're creating such a profile. In that scenario, if they try to even figure out that, you know, when they're hosting that data at their end, they will ensure, because this is a use case that is not something that Bagmishika Pohan is expecting, it is not even wise for an enterprise to keep any direct identifiers to, you know, entail that information for me. Because I will tell you why. Because tomorrow even I want to write, say, let's say I log into that request form, request page on Uber's profile. I know I would be shocked if I get a message or if I get an option there saying that please select on the basis of your rides that we will give you a dump of the number of visits you made to specific locations, or we will give you an analytics of how you went to number of religious places or how many restaurants you visited in this time period. That is something, a use case I would not want Uber to do for me. On the other hand, I will give you an example of Axis Bank. Axis Bank does this because I use Axis Bank, and on their app, if you see, they show you a behavioral pattern, your spending pattern. Has anybody else seen this?
Yes.
On any of the banking apps?
HDFC Bank does that too.
Huh. So most of the banks do that. So what they do is, when they're creating a spending analysis and they're creating that spending pattern, they call it, and they say, I think hospitality services, entertainment services, even entertainment is broken into multiple parts and things like that. There are headings separately called out. Now that is something Axis Bank can tomorrow or HDFC tomorrow can go and convince to the authorities that this is something, this is a value add we are giving to Bagmishika, because then she can decide or she can rethink her spending, and she can then choose if she wants to continue to spend more on hospitality sector, or then probably spend more on entertainment or something of that sense. So to be all of this, for any processing to happen, the controller has to be mindful of the fact that you should know that that use case should be expected. There should be a legitimate expectation. That is also a word, that's also a phrase used across GDPR a lot. So there should be a legitimate expectation on the part of the data subject that you will be putting their data to a similar use. So where I genuinely cannot think of any use cases where personal identifiers will continue to be in analyzed data sets. But that's not a good idea also as a controller to be doing, because that's also not permitted. You cannot retain any data in a set where you're analyzing and then mapping it to a personal identifier and keeping it. It is advised that you keep it in a masked form at least. So at least they should be pseudonymized. If not anonymized, they should at least be pseudonymized. So if that answers your question. I know I gave multiple examples there.
If I can think of a scenario, I'll let you know.
Please, huh? I'll be very happy, actually. I mean, probably that will give us a better perspective and understanding of how to go about it.
Sure.
We were talking about the Uber example. You were talking about the Uber example. I think even Uber sort of prepares a list or some compilation of data that we feed into. So like if I visit from point A to point B regularly in a week, the next week, while I'm feeding in my information for location, mm-hmm. it gives me those 4-5 options as the primary options, as the first options in its list.
Yes, and also because, you know, if you also notice, let's say I'm trying to book a cab at 8 in the morning, by default, all my devices which have Uber or Ola, they show TMT Law Practice.
Correct. That, exactly. And if you for a week stop visiting TMT Law Practice in that time duration, it will show other locations or might not show TMT Law Practice for that means.
True. For that matter, I will give you another example. There was this one or two instances. Actually, no. I didn't even turn my location on. But so there is a point, there is a split on the road I take to TMT, where if I take the right, I'm headed to office. If I take left, I head to Mehroli and the restaurants there. So because of my initial frequent visits to certain restaurants there, every time I would reach, I mean, if I have taken an Uber and I am nearing that particular signal where I have to, you know, there are fork where I take the right or the left, I would get a prompt from Zomato saying Olive is now offering this much discount, or Drams is offering this much discount. Those are restaurants there. So this is not even Uber. This is Zomato who is tracking my behavioral pattern, or it's probably using my location services when it's on, or it is try to extracting that data from Google, because Uber feeds that information from Google and feeds it back to Google. So yeah, that level of profiling is happening at the end of the day.
All right, sounds scary, but
it is. I am okay with them using my data as long as they let me be flexible with whatever I want to do. There are scarier examples. I will come to them later. So then right to data portability. This is again, it's not very difficult actually. There are certain difficult phrases which were introduced under GDPR and later on in the Personal Data Protection Bill. If you look at the first clause, it states that any data subject shall have the right to receive the personal data concerning him or her, which he or she has provided to a controller in a structured, commonly used and machine readable format, and have the right to transmit those data to another controller without hindrance from the controller to which the personal data have been provided. Okay, so now what has happened here is, first thing is the machine readable format is what I will try to explain to you. Structured is simple. It has to be in a format which is convenient. Commonly used, again, it has to be on system or tools which are commonly used across the ecosystem. And machine readable format they have tried to define it. There has been too much of discussion around it. Basically, it should be in a format which is capable of interaction with other systems. Now, let's say tomorrow I want to move from Uber to Ola or from Uber to Lyft. Uber should be able to give me all my information, which is essential for Ola or for that matter Lyft to be able to give me the same services that Uber presents to me. So if I'm asking, I'll give you a simple example only, that where I'm asking, do you think I'll give an example of Microsoft? Will that work better? Because Uber example could be more complicated. Okay, I take that as a yes. So now today we are hosted on Outlook servers. Tomorrow, if we decide that we want to move out of Outlook servers, we want to go to Google servers. In that scenario, when I am reaching out to Microsoft and I am telling them that you have to give me a file a folder which will download all the information that has been exchanged or that has been communicated or transacted on your platform for me to be able to pick this up from this system and take it to Google servers, they should give it to you in a format which will map with the other system. Now, data portability comes. The idea is that the transition for the data subject should be seamless and should be easy. But the data controller is not under an obligation to ensure that your data continues to be secure in the system of that second service provider. So your engagement or your relationship with the data controller to that limited extent ends the minute they have created a dump for you and made it available for you and you're moving out of their system. Now again, under data portability, what you are expected to receive from the data controller is all the information you have fed. Any information which is generating at their own end, they are not supposed to be making that available for you. So let's say if I've used Outlook enough for Outlook to know that there are certain emails which when I'm typing, it has to suggest ki you want to add, you want to mark Abhishek Malhotra, you want to mark Sapna Chaurasia. If I'm moving it from Outlook to Google, it is not Outlook's job to ensure that tomorrow on my Google server also, similar email or similar draft is that I get a prompt from Google server saying that you might want to mark Abhishek Malhotra or you might want to mark Sapna Chaurasia. Are you following? The concept of data portability is not difficult, but it is the assumption is that every player in the same ecosystem is at a similar level or is at par with one another to be able to enforce this. So for data portability to be smoothly be enforced in the country or for in any matter in any place, there is an expectation that players in similar ecosystems have similar capabilities, because the data controller is not the person who has to go ensure that whatever services or the level of services you are receiving from the data controller will continue to exist from the subsequent data controller or the service provider. Now that is right to data portability.
Is this particularly followed by all service providers? Because for example, we have Apple phones and all the data that's stored in an Apple phone, and if I want to shift to a Google server or an Android, the data to be ported from an Apple to an Android is not does not really happen. Like all the data that I have fed into my iPhone will not be, I cannot take it to an Android.
So the thing is, they will give it to you in a format. If you write to them, or if you're, when you're trying to create a file, you know, it's like how a dot pages file, a pages file from Apple does not open up in a system on Microsoft. You have to go find a different extension, right?
Right.
So similarly, like I said, the data controller can give it to you in a format which is generally accepted. So machine readable format means a format which is considered to be, you know, considered to be in a manner which can be processed by a system, but it does not have to be in a desirable format. I mean, you cannot force Apple to give it to you in, let's say, I mean, I cannot force Apple to make my system have only .docx version. It's as simple as that. So while there is a logical expectation that Apple will give it to you in a format which you can take and integrate it with system, I know the ease is not something that the data controller has to assure. So the extra element or another integration that you might have to do on the Android phone to be able to access your contacts is not something that Apple actually has to do for you. But if you see the other way around, it works. If you're trying to integrate something onto the Apple, if you have another app which uses Google servers or is allows you to log in through Google, then it becomes simpler for you to download your Google contacts. But again, on the Apple ecosystem, it is not easy. Matlab, what I'm trying to say is, within your Apple phones or your Apple devices, the Apple contacts per se might not make it easy for you to integrate Google contacts into that. But any other app within iOS system, any other app that you're downloading onto your Apple phone, let's say the Google Hangouts app, that might assist you, that might entertain your request to integrate your Google contacts. So a data controller is not under an obligation to make that, experience desirable for you. So a machine readable format is only a standard. It's not, a format that you desire to have it in.
Again, it's not an obligation on that.
No.
Okay.
And again, similarly, like I mentioned earlier, right of access maybe. Under right to data portability, when you, the first copy that is made available to you is free of cost. But if you want it to be done, like you said, if you want Apple to give it to you in a format which can be read by Google for free, with ease, then Apple has the right to charge a certain amount of fee. It cannot be exorbitant. It can be nominal, but it can be an administrative cost that they want from you to give it to you in that format.
Okay.
Okay. Can I move on?
Yeah.
This is the last of the rights. So I think if you guys can just go through clause one quickly. Article 6 refers to lawfulness of processing, and 9, I think, refers to sensitive personal information. 21 refers to right to object. And 8 refers to child's consent. Has everybody read it?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So there are several grounds, and when there is a mention of, you know, the data controller has to remove or erase all the data, personal data, without undue delay. The timeline is actually 30 days under GDPR, and even 30 days timeline is something where the data controller can reach out to the data protection authority and seek for more time basis, trying to figure out where all the data is actually hosted in. Because for while it is easier for a company to exercise, a company, when I say, I'm talking about purely from an employer-employee relationship, when it is social media intermediaries, or when it is a large entity like Google, or for that matter, Uber, who have information across multiple platforms because they're interacting with one another, that leeway, that much of leeway or justification is presented to the data controller, but that requires intervention of the data protection authority. Now, before I begin explaining this, I'll just show you what it looks like. Because all these rights can be exercised by a data subject, at all times the data controller has the right or has the option, the discretion to seek identity proof of the individual who is actually placing the request. Because without that, let's say there is some essential or, you know, let's say financial or health information which a data controller is holding on your behalf. If they start entertaining every single request without checking the authenticity of the source of such request, it will open up a can of worms. So that's why if you see the right to erasure or request form has this particular section where it's asking if it is the data subject directly or if there is another person who is working on behalf of the data subject. Now, if you see, this goes to the data protection officer of the data controller. And it just cannot be randomly sought from the data controller. You have to establish that the data that is available with the data controller and consequently the processor does not serve the purposes which, you know, they were originally collected for, or where you wish to withdraw your consent. Let me tell you that under the IT rules also, we have the option of withdrawing consent. So where you want to discontinue the services and you want to withdraw your consent, or where you are objecting to processing, this goes back to the right to object, or where you think your personal data has been put to unlawful use, and you know, where you think that because of a legal obligation or because of a because of the LEA actions or because of a court case or something requires your data to be erased, then, or if you're a child. Okay, so the last point is where information society services are nothing but online services, that is under Article 8 of the GDPR. A child under 16 requires consent of the adult who is, or the guardian who is acting on behalf of the child, but any a child above the age of 16 years can is free to give their own consent. So under Article 8 also, a child is typically expected to use and access only information society services, that is basic online services. They cannot, there cannot be social media intermediaries are not supposed to directly interact with children, or for that matter, target children who are on the online space after GDPR came into, became enforceable on 25th May 2018. So these are the grounds under which a person can actually seek from the data controller to erase all the information that is available on the systems of the data controller. Now, why, if you notice that for enforcement of any of these rights, it is essential that the data controller and the data processor have the same level of obligations or have similar obligations. And that is the reason I think, you know, Sani, I think you asked me yesterday why a data processor is obligated to follow all the same conditions. It is for this very purpose that tomorrow, if there is a request which is received by the data controller to exercise, I mean, for a person to exercise their right to erasure, it will be not complete unless and until the data processor actually goes ahead and implements all of it to the T. Because if there is some element which is residing in some aspect or in some place, then that will be in violation of this particular exercise. And so, it is essential at all times that the data controller and processor are on the same page.
Right. Many of the rights say so. Like, all rights are qua the controller, and no rights specifically talks about.
They actually don't speak. So if you see this chapter four, when it's discussing controller and processor, goes on to say that you have to, the data processor should be under the same burdens and obligations as the data controller is.
Alright.
Okay.
So again, here in case of non-compliance by the processor, let's say the primary controller deletes all the data. But the processor hasn't done it. So can the controller also be held liable under this section for that inaction on part of the processor?
Yes, because again, the controller is the one who is interacting with the DPI at any given instance. So what happens is, typically I'll tell you, once you are situated in any of these jurisdictions, I'll just try and show it to you actually. The ICO, all these information, I mean, the data protection offices have a registry where they host, see, they have a registry where they, sorry, I'm not sure if it's still there, where they host the list of data controllers and data processors. And within that, you also have the option to go ahead and mention, disclose all the data processors you are working with or all the data controllers that you are working for. I'll give you an example. If you see under this, I'm trying to see if they have been, no, so they do not have. Typically, if you see, even an Indian entity has been registered with the Information Commissioner's Office as a data controller. This is because if you see this person, the DPO, is responsible to ensure that any interaction that is happening between the data protection, the data protection authority and the data controller is, as, like I mentioned about the breach issue also, you have to be in constant interaction with them to be able to update them on anything that is happening at your end. because all these data protection authorities are also created with that in mind, that they interact with the DPOs and give them general guidance as to how to operate on a day-to-day basis. Now, in a scenario where you're saying that a data processor is actually the one who did not enforce, since the data subject wrote to me as the data controller for enforcing their rights, it is incumbent on me to go ahead and ensure that it happens. It doesn't matter how good is my relationship with the data processor, because again, for violation, it is the data controller who will be responsible. The data protection authority will come, in this case in UK, the information commissioner's office is going to come back to the data controller, not the data processor. I think I searched for data controller registry only. Okay, another, while we are still on this, I'll just show you another point. If you notice for jurisdiction for India, it is Srinivas Pusalla, he's the data privacy head. And for UK, there is a local person there. While the data protection officers do not necessarily have to be lawyers or do not necessarily have to have a specific background, educational background, they are supposed to be people who understand the privacy requirements, who understand the privacy principles, who understand the sector. So to be able to work in a desirable manner and to be working in the time frame, in the legal framework of the GDPR or the requisite data protection law. So to going back to your point, since it is the data controller who is reached out for enforcement of right, again, sanctions are against the data controller. It is not against the data processor. You again will have to fall back on the default clause. You have to notify to the DPA that this has happened. So in that scenario, fines will not be levied on you, but okay. The DPO will also give you a timeline or a strict mandate, or probably they list all of this on the website. So more than anything, while data breaches actually result in fines and the amount of fine that you pay is pretty high, what causes you more harm is the reputational damage which is associated with.
Right.
So exactly. So it's one of the features. So while you can actually, I think I typed for the data controller registry. Anyway, so that's how it happens. So at any given point of time, the good part about GDPR is all the data protection authorities are aware of how you function. So there is an open channel of communication at any point of time. In fact, if you have queries, you write to them, they respond to you.
Okay.
That is the culture that they follow so far. So this is the right, huh?
And then this would apply to data that the controller would have shared with any other third party, right? With consent of the data subject.
Yes. So it will include the data processors, the identified vendors, or if you go back to the HR scenario, it will apply to the banks. It will apply to because the banks have my account, it will not, they can't ask, my employer can't ask the bank to remove my account. They can just ask that you remove the link that is comes back to my company. That's it. So they can reach out to the payroll vendors. Or they can reach out to the insurance vendors. They can reach out to Zomato saying, de-link this person's relationship with my entity. And you have to purge any information which has flown from me to you.
Okay. And then that concept of vicarious liability will apply then with respect to all of the entities that the data controller would have passed on the data to?
More than that, that is there. But what typically happens is if you look at these MSAs, they're, like I mentioned yesterday, these are mostly unlimited liability clauses. There is no, typically all the data protection clauses, they have no, quantified or qualified, or there is no ceiling for damages and liabilities. They just keep it open-ended, because depending on what kind of fine they are looking at to be paying as data controllers is what they will want to be flown down to the data processor who actually probably crossed the breach or did not adhere to these enforcement.
Okay.
Will this right also secure us of the information that is aggregated by the controller or the processor in a secondary form, like which was not my personal information, not directly fed by me, but was aggregated by them? Will I be able to erase that information as well? For example, like hospitals maintain a data about you, and then calculate the number of births or female births and male births, will I be able to erase a part of my information that's fed into that record as well, or which was aggregated and compiled by them, or will I not be able to do that?
So again, try and understand that this is pertaining to direct identifier. This is information which is identifying you. So let's say if I somehow there is a certain thing that I did and I want Google to remove it from their search engines. Now in that scenario, let's say I have posted something on Facebook. Okay, I had created a post on Facebook in 2015, but I go to Google and I say, since your search engines also throw up such results and I want you to remove that particular links. What Google is obliged to do is it will probably try to remove all the links, which it will be in a format that when I type in Bagmishika Puhan, that should not be the first search which comes up. It can be pushed back to the 17th or the 18th page when I am landing there, because now Google has gone and it has crawled onto Facebook's website and it has pulled out that information from Facebook's page. Now this is possible because there is a direct identifier that somebody fed in to go look for Bagmishika Puhan. So it is to be able to protect the direct identifier, to remove any direct links to a data subject from the online ecosystem or the online environment. While on the other hand, Google has all rights to note that, to keep maintain a repository where it said a person of this age group situating in India has these many social media profiles, including Facebook, Instagram, WhatsApp, or Orkut or whatever. So again, like aggregated data sets, because they have already gone into a form which is no longer directly associated to you or cannot directly be traced back to you or linked to you, they are under no obligation to remove them.
Okay. All right.
Because in that sense, you cannot truly be, I mean, this is right to be forgotten. You can never truly be forgotten, because all the research and analytics that have happened basis your information will continue to exist. So these are the rights. Now, if you're done with the rights, we will move on to, I think we were supposed to discuss data localization today. Oh, sorry. I will do the cross-border transfers. I think Abhishek had asked me to touch upon a topic. So that will also cover data residency and data transfers. Sorry, cross-border transfers. So under GDPR, there are certain general elements. Actually, I'll go back to this page on this. There are certain general elements which allow a data controller to be able to share data outside the territorial jurisdiction of the European Economic Area. Now, the principles under which, so, okay, before I go there, I will explain two concepts. One is data residency. Data residency is when a company or an enterprise, you know, any entity decides to keep all the information pertaining to their businesses, their activities within a particular jurisdiction. And that is a conscious decision that the entity undertakes, probably for tax benefits, for, you know, for better regulatory environment or something. It is a voluntary decision which the entity takes. So that is the concept of data residency. Now, this in contrast to data localization is when the entity is obligated by the local, by the applicable laws, to host all the personal information and sensitive personal information that the company, the entity is processing, owns or has consumed, to be within a particular territorial jurisdiction. Now, have you understood this basic difference? Residency is voluntary, localization is an obligation. Is that clear to all?
Yeah.
Under GDPR and the European directive of 93, the privacy directive which predated the GDPR, both never said or do not talk of data localization, but they in fact have baked in principles which, you know, facilitated transfers outside the European economic area. Now, the criteria which have been mentioned here, some of them continue to be from before. Also had these particular features from before, even before the GDPR came into place. Now, there are certain conditions when companies based out of the European Economic Area can send out or can transfer personal information or sensitive personal information outside the European Economic Area. The conditions, the first condition is that it could be on the basis of adequacy safeguards. I will quickly mention the conditions and then I will explain each one of them separately. The second one is when there is appropriate safeguards is more in the nature of contractual relationship that you exist, that you enter into between the party that you're transferring to. Third one is binding corporate rules, which now finds a similar thing under the Personal Data Protection Bill, which is known as the intra-organizational schemes. And then there is transfers or disclosures not authorized by union law. So I'll walk you through each one of them separately. The first one is on the basis of an adequacy decision. Adequacy is the European Data Protection Board, EDPB, and earlier the Article 29 Working Party sat together with the European Commission and all those representatives, and they basis these points. Basis these three points decided if a certain country can be designated as a country with adequate level of protection or not. The elements that they consider is that the country that, you know, an entity from within EEA is wanting to transfer in personal information or sensitive personal information should have adequate respect for human rights and fundamental freedoms, should have adequate data protection rules, should have, like the point B mentions, an existence and effective functioning of one or more independent supervisory authorities. And the third and final one is, you know, it should also subscribe to the international commitments or to be, it subscribes to other legal or multilateral instruments whereby data privacy and protection measures are considered as one of the essential elements for the country to follow. Now, to this date, India is not recognized as a country which has adequate level of protection, adequate safeguards. There are very few countries that the European Data Protection Board recognizes as to be adequate for data to be transferred. Now, what is important is where, for let's say for Europe to transfer data to a country like Singapore, the data controller does not have to go back to the data protection authority all the time, but it is a transfer that they can make happen without actually looking for any additional rider, because these countries have been identified and they have been notified as countries with adequate level of protection. So there is no extra qualification criteria, or there is no additional formality that a data controller has to enter into or engage in to be able to send information to any of those, any of the entities which are situated in any of these countries outside the territorial jurisdiction of the European Economic Area. Now, that is one criteria. Second criteria is the transfer subject to appropriate safeguards. If you see here, this, the appropriate safeguards refer to something as standard contractual clauses. They are talking about legally binding and enforcement instruments between public authorities or bodies. So this also includes MLATs and any bilateral treaties between two countries. And there's something which is important known as the standard data protection clauses. Standard data protection clauses is something like this. This is the European Commission website. And the European Commission website, even before the GDPR, under the European Data Privacy Directive of 93, also had this in place. If you read this, it states that there are two sets of SCCs for data transfers from data controllers in the EU to data controllers established outside the EU or European Economic Area. And then again, one set of contractual clauses for data transfers from controllers in the EU to processes established outside the EU or EEA. Typically, most of the companies, they actually just pick this up and use the same format without making multiple changes. I mean, of course, you have to make changes which are typical to your own sector. but the SCCs form as a valid, all the clauses that are mentioned in a standard contractual clause, what happens is typically an MSA is drafted and executed with an annex, with an annexure which control, which covers all of this. Can you see this?
Yes.
So while there is existence, even while a company, let's say based out of, you know, Marriott wanting to transact out of the UK, or let's not say UK, let's say out of the German offices wants to transact with the Singaporean office, and they're trying to send out information, they can fall back on a, you know, on the same, on simple agreement, but they must have an annexure which says and contains this, the standard contractual clauses, which specifically identifies the data exporter, the data importer. And if you see, these are the basic, these are the basic definitions which are provided therein. And these are the clauses that will continue to operate on both the parties. So this is something which can be imported into the agreement that you are drafting. And this is considered as a valid mean or a valid mechanism to facilitate transfers, across border transfers, across, I mean, outside of EEA. I think Sahil, you had questions about liability, right?
With respect to what? Liability of?
I mean, in case of breaches and damages.
Yes.
So do you want to go through this clause? This is between a, mind you, this is between a controller and a controller.
Okay.
So it could be common entity. I mean, it could be group entity also. It could be in that scenario. But there, so this is how typically a liability clause is structured. If you look at point three, I mean, clause six, subclause three.
Yes.
So they have highlighted, they are aware of the fact that indemnification is how most of these entities go about. So that is already baked into what is typically a standard contractual clause. So what will happen is, let's say tomorrow, Merrill Lynch goes on and hires Infosys to create a software from them. And let's say it's a Merrill Lynch EA entity, which is actually entering into an agreement with Infosys. Then what they will do is, apart from the standard MSA, which has all the requirements, which has the SOW, which has the SLA and everything baked into it, they will add this. They will add as an annexure, this standard contractual clause is added. And then a copy of this again goes back to the data protection authority for their review in case of, you know, absence of any adequate safeguards. So it is a standard, it's a good practice that everybody follows. Most of the IT companies adhere to this. And then I'll show you what happens in case of a data controller to processor. So there are, this is written controller to processor. In fact, all the data protection authorities have the Word formats also. So for you to be able to do it. Sorry. Do you read this thing? This is between a controller and a processor. Does that actually answer most, I mean, your queries?
Yeah, but this first part says receive compensation from the data exporter. which I believe
controller.
Which would be the controller, right?
Huh. This is a controller to processor.
This is so here even in case of a breach by the processor, the data subject would be able to directly claim compensation from the data exporter, which is the controller, correct?
Yes. And if you see, it goes on to say that the data importer, that is the processor, may not rely on a breach by a subprocessor of its obligations in order to avoid its own liabilities.
Okay.
Because then again, it will stand as a data controller and the subprocessor will stand as a data processor to the data processor.
Right.
So, in case the data importer, there's a breach by the subprocessor, and then the data importer will be held liable, but in turn, again, the data exporter will be held liable, right?
So data exporter is the controller here. The reason it has been mentioned in this fashion is for a data subject, like for you and I do not know who all Uber or Google or Facebook engage with to actually be doing supporting their IT services. So for me, my recall is Facebook or Google. I will directly write to them. I do not care about how or who they use for the purpose of effecting or making my services available to them. So that is why these clauses are structured in a manner where they're focusing on the data exporters liabilities. And then this clause, this portion, if you see, this is part of the standard contractual clauses which have been defined by the European Commission itself in extension as an explanation or as an extension of the GDPR. So that is where all of this the intent is to ensure that it is the controller who is the first the first person of contact, and then in the absence of the controller, it goes back to the data importer. But further trickle down is very difficult because you cannot just sit and keep on identifying all the subprocessors or vendors who have been engaged by the subprocessor for the purpose of a particular transaction to occur.
But a data subject would have to be given information about all the data processors that a data controller engages, right, with respect to
So within the notice, the idea is that the best practice is for a data controller to actually go ahead and say all the data processes that they engage. But there is always an option to the best knowledge of data controller. But then the law also understands that tomorrow the data controller might not want to continue a particular, let's say, an IT support service, and they want to move from one company to the other. So it is not easy for them to go back and update the consumer at every single day or every single instance. So for that reason is why, all of us find the wiggle room to actually go ahead and write that processors or entities hired for IT services, entities hired for customer referrals, entities hired for customer support. We try to mask all of it, right? All of us do it.
Yeah.
But to the extent necessary, of course, you will have to let them know. And because imagine, and this is happening because it is cross-border transfer, all the more reason that the EPD or the European Commission sat down and created these standard contractual clauses. This is processors, and the earlier one I showed was control-specific, controller to controller.
So it's essentially been effectuated to make it friendly for the consumer, convenient for the consumer to directly go and hold the controller on the line for every single breach.
Exactly.
And then the controller would have the contractual right to claim a back-to-back indemnity from its processors.
Yes. I'll just tell you. So if you see in this subclause, it has been clearly mentioned where a processor is engaging another processor, they have to flow down all the obligations that the controller has. Similarly, the explanation for controllers also has a similar provision which says that the controller must ensure, I just showed to you. I'll tell you where it is. I'll tell you the exact provision, which actually also mentions that a data controller has to flow down all its obligations to the data processors. That also I will share with you. So that is one bit. I was not able to locate the exact provision. It could also be part of the recitals. I'll pull that out and share with all of you. Now, this is the concept which requires discussion, and I think Abhishek also wanted me to clarify on this. So binding corporate rules came as a concept when, if you see, I mean, the example that I had given you of Infosys ICO registry, what happens is for a company like Infosys, which has presence in about 50 odd countries, and it's possible that Infosys India, if is engaged by Wells Fargo, let's say Infosys Bangalore office has a team which is working with Wells Fargo, and let's say there is a team situated out of San Francisco which is working with Wells Fargo, and there's another team situated out of Germany which is also working on the same Wells Fargo account. What will happen is there is bound to be it is invariable that there is no flow of personal information which is taking place, actually personal and sensitive personal information which is taking place between these three specific geographies and three different continents, actually. So now, to facilitate for larger groups or MNCs to be able to work seamlessly, or to be able to work, you know, cohesively and also in sync with one another and have the same set of privacy rules, this concept of binding corporate rules came in. This was not there under the privacy directive. This was introduced under the GDPR. And it is not very difficult. The binding corporate rules specify, if you see, they have to identify all the group of undertakings or enterprises that are covered under that particular rule. So a BCR is actually a set of compendium or a manual which has the structure and contact details of the group. It also carries the value of being binding in nature, both internally and externally. So sometimes when these larger data controllers interact with data processors, they also send a link to the BCR where the data processor goes through the binding corporate rules which applies to the data controller. Then it has all the principles that the privacy principles that the company internalizes or at an enterprise level, rolls out in forms of policy, in forms of decisions, in forms of processes. They have all to be called out and put in the binding corporate rules. And again, they also have to highlight the rights of data subjects which are available to everyone, and they have to be same. So the only fight that BCR has is that, let's say we are in a jurisdiction like Europe, but then there is an entity there is a company situated out of Brazil. While Brazil has bits and pieces of data protection laws, it does not have a comprehensive legislation and does not have same level of privacy requirements or obligations for handling sensitive information and personal information in Brazil. But by virtue of the fact that an entity situated out of Europe has agreed to create a binding corporate rule which will cover all its undertakings, all its subsidiaries and enterprises across the globe, and by virtue of the fact that these BCRs are actually submitted to the data protection authority and certified by them, the subsidiary sitting in Brazil is also under an obligation to follow all of this in the same manner that the entity in Europe or India or Germany, US will be obligated to follow. So that is how it works. Similarly, what the Personal Data Protection Bill has done, they have come up with an intra-group or intra-department organizational schemes, which has the same features. That also has to be ratified by the Data Protection Authority, which will tomorrow come up, and it will bind all the enterprises which are identified within that ecosystem, within that manual. So what happens is, apart from the fact that there is possibility that there is no adequacy for that country, but by virtue of the fact that this particular organization abides by the BCR, abides by ensures that the levels of protection or policies which are highlighted in the binding corporate rules applies to all entities, the transfer is free. There is no, again, if a BCR is once executed and has been submitted to a data protection authority, so going back to the Infosys example, if that had the BCR has been submitted with the UK ICO or with the German BDSG, then what will happen is information flowing from Infosys Germany to Infosys India will not always require to meet other requirements under other requirements for cross-border transfers, and it can happen seamlessly because it's the same group at the end of the day bound by the same principles. So that is how binding corporate rules work. And I think Abhishek had mentioned that question that in case for Indian MNCs, this is what happens. So in the previous organization I used to work with, like we were also registered with the ICO, with the BDSG as data controllers and data processors also. So what would happen is, because it was a large IT company, what would typically happen is the BCRs were submitted and they were, BCRs were documented, created, documented and submitted. They were floated across all those 65 or 67 jurisdictions that we operated in. And under the purview of those BCRs, and on top of that, also adding that, you know, all the MSs would have an SCC annex to the end of it, and adhering to also consent mechanisms and all of that, we would allow free transmission of information or, you know, cross-border transfers. Because sometimes what happens is, especially in IT companies, when you're working with on a vendor or when you're working with a client, you not only have your own email address for your company's, I mean, let's say on behalf of Infosys, you will also have an email ID which will be pertaining to Wells Fargo, which will have different information available on your systems. So that is why it becomes essential for any large MNC to have intra-group schemes. Even tomorrow, let's say the Personal Data Protection Bill does not become the law, even without that, it is advisable to have concept like the binding corporate rules, because these become the go-to manual in case of a breach, in case of you know, escalation, in case of decision making on right enforcement. So BCRs are kind of the golden standard right now. So, and they actually lend a lot of credibility and ease of doing business between group entities, because you do not always have to go back to the DPA for you know, multiple certification and then to be able to be in a position to make a transfer. So that is how BCRs are looked at. Now, apart from that, like the US and European Union, there is something called the Privacy Shield. By virtue of Privacy Shield, the cross-border transfer between European Economic Area and US also is very, has been eased a lot. So that is another way that cross-border transfers are allowed under GDPR. This is again, this again speaks of MLATs, or where, you know, there is a cross-border transfer which is required by a member state for, you know, enforcing any issues or concerns within that particular member state. Under MLATs, you can also be required to transfer. Okay, there's another difference. If you see, it's mentioned transfers or disclosures. Disclosures are typically in the sense that there is a legal authority which is involved and you are trying to make disclosures to them for rights enforcement, while transfers could be a contractual need. Most of the jurisdictions do not make a distinction between this, but in day-to-day practice, that is the distinction between a transfer and a disclosure. So with that, I think, is everybody clear on transfers?
Cross-border. Yes.
So I think then we can move on to data localization law, which is not anything which was, GDPR does not provide for any data protection, data localization. It in fact facilitates cross-border transfers. On the other hand, it was, there was a point where we were expecting that the Personal Data Protection Bill will require data localization to be the norm. Even having said that, the financial sector already has obligations and mandates which require data to be localized and data to be stored and resided and hosted only in India. So there are multiple elements to it. There are multiple questions which, you know, plague all of us. What happens in case of data, the advantage of having data across multiple jurisdictions or across multiple locations within one particular jurisdiction is that there is an option for you to be able to retrieve data. Let's say I have an office in Bombay, Bangalore, and Chennai and Delhi. Now, if you recollect that during the Chennai floods, multiple IT companies were, because of the inundation, water logging and all, their backup instances failed. So, given a scenario where they were forced to localize their information, and let's say for a company which had only one backup instance, and that was the Chennai office, if they were not allowed to host backup instances in other geographies, in other jurisdictions, so in scenarios like this, in case of, let's say, public emergency, or in case of a national emergency, a natural calamity, the cost that goes into retrieving all that information is too high. So from a cost perspective, data localization is something that is not favored by enterprises. And also because what happens is certain countries might not have the level of data protection or a desirable data privacy and protection framework, but you as an enterprise could be more conscious and might be wanting to afford a higher level of security, or give more privacy, and allow further more rights to data subjects. So all of that becomes a challenge if data localization becomes the norm. Having said that, Personal Data Protection Bill initially also did not allow for sensitive personal data to be taken outside the country. Currently, personal data can be taken outside the country. And initially, it was also mentioned that you will have to create a mirror, as in you will have to create a backup instance and have it available here on Indian servers. Now, that requirement has gone away. But sensitive personal information can be taken outside the country with the explicit consent of the data subject under the current circumstances and in the present scenario is how the bill looks like right now after the last version came out in December. Having said that, the pending legislation also has this new criteria which says that the central government retains the right to classify a particular set of particular categories of data as critical personal data. Now, most of us are suspecting that that could be financial or sensitive or health information. Now, what will happen is, should a sensitive personal data identify qualify, or sensitive personal data category qualify as critical personal data, now that information cannot be taken outside the country. That has become a challenge under the pending data protection bill. So that is how data localization plays out. And I think you guys have to start asking me questions for me to be able to explain to you in context. Otherwise, I will just, I'll be rambling on random, on different tangent altogether. So for whatever we have discussed, does anybody have any questions?
Bhagmiksha, hi, Hiral here.
Hi, Hiral.
So while we were talking about the transfers, does this also include data servers?
Data, okay, that's a good point actually. No, transfers, yes. So what happens is, let's say I'm logging a view access. Like I'll give you an example of Gmail. I don't know where my Gmail servers are hosted, right? But every time I log into my page, the first page that I see, the access page, the viewing page, also is a download.
Yes.
So in that sense, it also qualifies as a transfer. So in that sense, your data servers, if they're hosting information outside the country, outside whatever jurisdiction, that will be considered as a transfer.
Okay. And so then in case of like a legal dispute, how does this work? I'm trying to understand it from an Indian perspective because, most of the things that we use, the servers are outside the country. Mm-hmm. So in terms of a legal dispute, how does the jurisdiction play out in this case?
So in that case, GDPR, typically PDP bill, we will have to wait how it actually comes to become the law. Under GDPR, you can move, but you will have to go to the European Economic Area to actually enforce it against a controller or a processor there. That is under GDPR, okay. That's how it exists. But it allows foreign national to actually go ahead and sue a data controller or processor there. It is not limited only to European citizens.
Got it.
Is there any specific questions that anybody has?
If you could if you could throw some light on the territorial scope of the GDPR, the applicability, because I think recently the European Data Protection Board had come up with a set of guidelines. And there was a lot of confusion as to, you know, whether it would apply to someone who's collecting data of European citizens while they are not in the European Union. Something on those lines.
Okay, so if you see initially, I mean, Article 3 of the regulation states that it is it actually opens with saying that it applies to the processing. I'm reading out the provision. It applies to the processing of personal data in the context of the activities of an establishment of a controller or a processor in the union, regardless of whether the processing takes place in the union or not. So, and the fact is the term processing actually covers everything from the point of collection of data to the point to transfers, to disclosures, to movement, to internal transfers, access, all of it is covered under processing. So the territorial scope, it extends to entities which are processing information pertaining to the citizens of the European Union. In fact, all the guidelines have also gone ahead and said that. So keeping this in mind, in fact, what the Indian legislation initially did was said that that the bill will also apply to processing of personal data of data subjects who are situated outside the country when it goes beyond a certain volume. Let's say today I use Yelp once and I'm an Indian citizen. I am in the states or I'm in whichever country which also has Yelp and I'm using it once. And on Yelp's profile, I'm the only foreign citizen. Now that particular reason is not for, I mean, it is not enough reason for Yelp to actually start complying with the Indian Data Protection Bill. This is, both the legislatures have been mindful of that fact that they have to look at the volume of processing before they actually go ahead and say if it applies to a particular entity or not. But what is frowned upon and what will make you subject to GDPR or for that matter will make you subject to PDP bill is if you start monitoring behavior. So if you start profiling the individual situated outside situated in a different jurisdiction, you will be subjected to GDPR under GDPR and also under the PDP bill, I mean, when it becomes the law. So volume of data and monitoring, they both depend. And if you're asked for, sorry, I'll just mention one more point. And also if you're targeting at that particular jurisdiction and offering goods or services. So then again, you will go back to those basic concepts of jurisdiction, personal jurisdiction that were already prevalent under the cyber regime.
Right. So if an Indian entity is collecting the personal data of a European citizen, while that European citizen is, let's say, in India or outside the European Union, then GDPR would not become applicable, right?
Again, like I said, for one individual, but you know what? So GDPR, I will just tell you. Wait. If you're talking about if the person will be able to enforce his rights and will be able to challenge or not, under GDPR, they won't be. But that is the idea. The Personal Data Protection Bill should be able to cover it. Another thing which the scope of GDPR states is that the regulation will apply to the processing of personal data by a controller not established in the union, but in a place where member state law applies by virtue of public international law.
This will be with respect to the embassies, right?
Yes.
consulate offices that you have.
Huh.
Right. But generally, let's say I have a European visitor in my office, and data of that visitor is collected at, let's say, the entrance. Then I don't have to comply with any GDPR there.
No, you will have to comply with the Personal Data Protection Bill. Now, let's say for a company like I keep mentioning IT companies, because IT companies, if it's an employee, if it's a regular visitor, again, Sahil, so if it's a regular visitor who is a foreign national, okay, they will be subjected to, you will expect that, you know, your company is in compliance with the Personal Data Protection Bill or the Indian laws. But let's say it's your employee who has come from Germany or, you know, from Netherlands.
Mm-hmm.
Then in that scenario, you should be mindful of the fact that because the entire objective of GDPR was also that they have a different social construct. And I actually will give you an example. If you look at the candidate application forms for any of these European nations, the employee forms or the employee enrollment forms are not, they carry 3 or 4 questions. They do not have more than that. But if you look at, you know, the Indian companies or Indian, entities, they are multiple pages, sometimes more than 20 pages, because I have signed a 20-page document initially. So in that scenario, there is a logical expectation, because what is going on in their head is that I am a EU citizen. While they are appreciative, because I'm saying this from practical experience, while they're appreciative of the fact that they're not in the jurisdiction, but what is going on in their head is that I'm still an employee of the same company, so I'm expecting at least similar level of protection. But for practical purposes, doesn't happen. So when they're here, if you look at how to deal with it, you will, the IT laws of the country will prevail. Unless and until, you know, actually cause them that much level of harm.
Bhagmi, I've sent you 2 questions on your WhatsApp.
Just a minute. Let me try and post that question here. Let me just log into my web WhatsApp so that everybody can read.
I'll read it out to people. Then you can answer it. So question number 1 is, a research file containing 1 million search keywords of about 200,000 job seekers over a 3-month period intended for research and analytics purposes. This is the collection of the data. The person who's asking the question says, we did not identify the users in the report. However, at the very minimum, personally identifiable information was present in many of the queries which was asked. And as the queries were attributed by us to particular user accounts identified numerically, an individual could be identified and matched to their account and search history by such information. Whether the leakage of such information by the data controller will be considered as a breach.
So personally identifiable information is a term typical to the American construct, and it is a wider definition, and the scope is wider than what personal data is. So if I can get an example of what could be this PII, I can actually probably give you a decent answer. But if I just look at it, I can say that by the looks of it, of course, it will be, you will be considered to be in breach in case of a leak. But if you can just give me,
What I will do is I'll ask Deepak. Deepak has asked this question. I'll ask him to separately pose it directly to us. But this is what my answer to him also was. The second question, because he couldn't come back on the call. Second question he raised is that a sample primary survey done by an ad agency at the behest of a client on consumer behavior or buying pattern. Agency complies and gives the report to the client. Whether the client can use the data contained in the sample survey to create another analysis.
Okay, so sample No, again, so agency is the data processor, right?
Correct.
So this is typically what I'm trying to say, that the data controller has not, you have to look at the contractual arrangement also, that if the data controller at any point of time agreed to give the aggregated data sets or any access to the DP, the data processor, but you cannot use it without any specific consent where, so what typically happens is the consent which the data controller has is also given to the data processor for the data processor to see that these are the terms of use we use. This is the privacy policy of our entity and you are supposed to work in this framework. So that consent also flows to the data processor for the data processor to be able to gauge and to be able to ascertain if they can use, they can find new use cases or if they can repurpose the information which is available with them. It could be flowing from the data controller. So again, you will have to look at the consent form for this particular entity. But having said that, if there is no clear understanding or there is no clear mandate from the data controller, the data processor cannot do this.
Correct. Absolutely. Fine. I think that pretty much brings us to the end of this session. Bhami, is there anything else that needs to be discussed at a conceptual level in terms of concepts, rights, etc.?
No, I think I've pretty much covered everything else. And if I go deeper, it will be purely technical.
No, if you go deeper, then we won't be able to charge money. Anyway, so as I said, this will bring us to the end of the session. And thank you very much all for joining us. And thanks a lot, Bhagni, for that wonderful exposition. And people who have joined us, we are reverting to our regular time of 11:30 to 1:30 from Monday onwards. We are possibly going to be taking up the insolvency and bankruptcy code, though we had also thought about some a session around content regulation, you know, the CBFC, Cinematograph Act, etc. We'll just try and send you messages by tomorrow as to what exactly we decided in terms of the topic. But in all probability, I'm thinking of doing insolvency and bankruptcy code. So I would like to invite everyone back on this session on Monday and then take it forward. Thank you so much, all.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bhagmisha. Thanks, Abhishek.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Happy weekend.
Thank you. You too.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you.